MER is a European EV charging company owned by Statkraft, Europe's largest producer of renewable energy. As one of the fastest growing EV charging companies with over 36,000 charge points across Europe, MER brings together over 10 years experience in the electric mobility industry. From depot charging for large commercial fleets to public sector organizations with a portfolio of sites with different charging requirements, we provide end-to-end bespoke EV charging solutions for businesses with a fleet of vehicles. When working with MER, fleet managers can be confident that their entire process of installing and managing your charging infrastructure is taken care of. From site design and consultancy to charge point installation, grid connection to renewable energy supply, and back office management to aftercare support, we have the expertise to provide a full turnkey solution for your EV charging needs. We recognize that no two fleets are the same, and therefore treat our charging solutions the same way. MER provides the best infrastructure to suit your individual needs, prioritizing quality and technology to guarantee reliability and efficiency in the long term. Your fleet vehicles are business critical. We can ensure your charge points are consistently powered up, and we can react quickly when faults are identified, so your vehicles are never compromised. MER advocates for charging EVs with clean energy and combines our expertise in EV charging with Statkraft's 125-year legacy in renewable energy. We offer our fleet customers zero carbon, 100% renewable electricity sourced solely from solar, wind, and hydro. Work with an agile EV charging partner with strong financial backing and sustainable ambitions.
Good morning. Thanks everybody for coming to this session, which is how to plan your electric transition. We've got a great panel this morning. We have Matt Neale, Head of Fleet and MaaS for Platform Housing Group, Joe Hammonds, Head of Fleet Services for Sanctuary Group, Matt Dale, Director at TZConsulting, and Natasha Fry, who's Head of Sales at MER. And MER, you've just seen the video, are our session sponsor, so thank you. I'm going to ask the panel if they could just introduce themselves properly and just explain a little bit about your role and where you are involved in electrification, particularly if you're a fleet, and then obviously and the suppliers, about how you help fleets. Just a minute or two each, if that's okay, and I'll start with you, Matt.
Okay, so I'm Matt Neale from Platform. We run a solely commercial fleet at the moment, and we run about 700 vehicles. In regards to our EV journey, we currently we started it back in 2022. It's been a painful journey. However, we are progressing, moving forward, and we're now steadily getting into a steady pace to transition out to the rest of our commercial fleet.
Thank you. Joe?
Yeah, hi, Joe Hammonds. I'm Head of Fleet Services at Sanctuary Group. We've got a fleet of around 1,800 vehicles, mixture of light commercials and cars, mainly light commercials, 1,400 of those, around 350 company cars and some specialist stuff as well. So, and like a lot of people, we've taken the steps to start our EV transition. We're doing all right, but there's an awful lot more challenges ahead that we can certainly look at and discuss over the next half an hour or so.
Sure,
so,
yeah. Thanks, Joe. Matt?
Hi, good morning everybody. Matt Dale. So I've been in automotive for the last 40 years, and for the last 3 years I have been working with various clients, helping them understand how to start their transition to electric, all the way through from vehicle, strategy to deliver, infrastructure, driver training, everything that fits in between, electrification for the last 12 years, and did a bit of work with Matt.
And Natasha.
And last but not least, hi everyone, really good to be here. I'm Natasha, and as you've already introduced, I head up sales for MER. So for those of you that aren't familiar, I appreciate that the brand here in the UK might not be as popular as some of the other bigger companies that offer these services. So we're owned by a company called Statkraft, so European big company. MER's the mobility arm of that. And here in the UK, I represent our fleet side of the business. So for the last 7 years, we've been on a bit of a journey with some customers, and a lot of them, to help them transition into electrification, helping them with the challenges that come with that, and the EV infrastructure that we deliver for our clients. So I've been in the industry a long time. Fleet's my background. Worked with, I mean, Joe and I have just caught up after. We've worked together before in my previous life. So fleet for us is our background. Totally different to public charging and CPO charging. So yeah, that's me. Lovely to meet you all.
Thank you. There's been a couple of comments there about challenges you've faced and challenges you will face. So very basic question. What would, if someone's out there now and they're going to go back in the office tomorrow and say, right, I am going to start my transition, what advice would you give them? What should they do first?
To me?
To you, Matt.
So I think, first of all, I'd make sure that you talk to your business and make sure the business is actually ready to do it. We started that, and we did get board sign-off, but the area of the business that we support wasn't necessarily ready for EV. So we kind of had quite a bit of pushback. So I'll definitely make sure that you get all of the stakeholders buy-in in to be able to do it. And set out a time scale that's actually going to be achievable. So when I first started the business, I wanted to transition my whole fleet by 2026. And I can laugh about it now because that's never going to happen. But we set up with a real ambitious target that was kind of unachievable. So I'd probably recommend that you just make sure you set yourself an achievable target that's going to support your own business.
How quickly in did you realise it was unachievable?
When we started getting lots of pushback from the business, to be fair. I work for Platform Housing Limited, and I look after Platform Property Care. They're my customer, effectively. And I didn't understand their organisation or their business, so I didn't understand the impact it would have to the operatives, the drivers, and obviously all the complexities around public charge and home charge. And there was a lot more conversation, I think a lot more questions that needed to be asked before we actually started the journey. Sure. And it's almost like we probably would have been, if I look back, I think it would have been a lot easier if I kind of sat down with everybody, created like a working group and went through everybody's challenges and got everything on the table to start with, as opposed to working more of on a siloed basis. But yeah.
And when you say got everybody together, do you mean board and drivers themselves?
So the board wanted us to transition our whole fleet within a year. But again, I think that comes down to people's not understanding that that isn't actually possible. And I'd love to see anybody that can do that. But the board wanted it straight away. So the challenge wasn't from the board. We had the investment from the organisation, so it wasn't to do with money either. It was literally to do with the operational challenges that it was going to face by doing them, because we targeted heavily on performance and service delivery. So if we can't get out to the vehicles or get out to the properties to service them and repair them, we can be pulled over the coals certain regulations we have to adhere to and all that sort of stuff in our business as well. So, and it's all those complexities that we didn't understand when we kind of set out on the journey.
So be realistic is kind of the message there.
Yeah, definitely be realistic.
Joe, what advice would you give?
I think for me, as Matt said, I think any business you're in has got to have a desire to do it. There's no point in trying to force it on the business, so the business has got to have that desire to start with. And then I think, certainly in our point of view, we had to have a very clear strategy on how we were going to deliver that. So Matt's talked about timings, talked about ambitions of how quickly you want to do it, how quickly you can transition parts of the business, and maybe different parts of the business go quicker than others, etc. So you need to have that in that strategy piece. We clearly found to start with there's a very clear separation between cars and commercials. And I think we'll probably touch a lot more on that later on in this session, but we certainly found that straight away. So cars, we set a very ambitious target. So we were going to change all our company cars into EVs by 2028, which I think is very achievable, and we're still on target to do that. Okay. Commercials, we'd like to be in 2030. That was obviously set in stone. Yes. That might change again now.
Yeah.
I think realistically, we will struggle to hit that date just because of that transition. So I think as long as you've got that strategy set out to start, I think you've got a clear direction of travel. And coupled with that strategy, look at the finances, because these things aren't cheap to buy.
No.
And depending on how you fund those vehicles, you've got a different cost profile than you would do of a normal kind of ICE engine vehicle, diesel engine vehicle, etc. So,
sure. Yeah. And Matt, sort of how do you start conversations with fleets wanting to transition?
What the guys have spoken about are really key. The stakeholder piece is absolutely critical, especially with an operational fleet. You've got to get buy-in from everybody and everybody to understand the direction of travel. As Joe says, this isn't a cheap solution. Transitioning an operational fleet has a cost, it has an impact on the way you deliver your service. Cars are a lot easier, and a lot of people are doing a lot of car stuff, and that's an easier process. Think about the impact it has on your drivers. They're the people that deliver your business. So you've really got to involve them in the process. If you're going for home charging, make sure that it fits in an ecosystem so you can reimburse them for the cost of the energy they use and things like that. And really be realistic with your timeframes. Transitioning an entire operational fleet by 2030 is really, really tough. There will be vehicles that can't be transitioned. Go for the low-hanging fruit first. There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with identifying those easiest vehicles to transition. And then leave the more difficult ones to later on. Don't worry about them today. There's a lot of technology change happening in the automotive industry. Vehicle ranges will extend. Infrastructure that you deploy will still be valid even if vehicles, will still be useful even if vehicles have a longer range. So just be sensible about everything, I suppose. Take a really pragmatic approach to it and be realistic in your targets.
So Natasha, infrastructure was mentioned then. Mm-hmm. Is that the type of conversations that you're having with customers around the infrastructure?
There's a common theme here, right? There are going to be so many stakeholders involved in this because, A, the investment from a financial perspective is going to be big. There are other funding models that you can explore. But also there's going to be, my advice would be, don't do this alone, you know. Matt, you mentioned that you wish you'd have waited a little bit to get the strategy in place. I'm going to contradict you slightly because from my perspective, it's kind of get the experts in as early as possible. And that helps to identify what is actually physically possible. And things like external factors, power constraints, grid connections, understanding what those vehicles do in the environment they're supposed to operate in, that all takes time because if you work with an organisation that gets under the skin of that, what you then start to understand and establish is there are solutions out there that fit your business. Each depot will be different, each operating unit will be different. So when it comes to, you need to be, understand that you have to be agile. Your strategy that you start out with will evolve, will develop, will change over time. So if you can bring in experts from certain areas that know their craft, that can guide you and advise you on these things from OEMs through to EV charging companies, I think you could really take advantage of some really early conversations that can help you over time because this isn't a quick fix, right? And you know, Matt, you're right, there's some low-hanging fruit you can go after, but you've got to look at the bigger picture. And I think a lot of what you end up procuring may go through tender process. You know, a lot of organizations will want to do that. And the market is inundated and saturated with options for you. And I accept it can be quite confusing. So get yourself in a place where you're armed with the knowledge and the facts. And then when you do go out to your supply chain, there's more of a like-for-like scenario that you're asking for then fair pricing, fair transparency. The other thing I would say is data is key. You know, be transparent. You're not going to get everything right straight away, and it's about just owning it, admitting that that's the case, and just working together as a collaboration to get to a point where, you know, you're succeeding in this space. It's not easy. It's achievable, though, and I think you take it in bite-sized chunks.
And I assume strategies evolve. They can't. You can't plan a strategy now, and it's that same strategy in 3 years' time. Obviously, what you were saying, you would. Is that correct? I mean, how far removed?
Our strategy has evolved massively since starting the journey. And Matt was in his capacity when he worked at Mighty, supported us with that. And we didn't have the knowledge in our organisation for EV. I think when we first started the journey, everyone became an EV specialist. And we didn't have that insight in our own organisation. So we reached out to a partner to kind of support us with that because we had to. And then we tendered for a partner to kind of support us on our EV infrastructure journey because, again, we didn't have that knowledge. So we realised that early on that we kind of needed that support. But our strategy's changed massively because we've, from when we very started to where we are now, we're in two completely different situations. And you kind of need to evolve it, really, as the time goes by. Like, we wanted to, like, transition all of our commercial vehicles by a certain date. And, like, there's, at the moment, for example, we have tippers, and we can't transition a tipper. I know there's an electric version of a Transit, but we can't transition a tipper into EV because we don't have any towing capabilities either to be able to do that at the moment. So, and Ford haven't brought any, like, a product out to kind of support us with that. So we know that we can't do that. So those are kind of sat in, like, a pool area to, like, until we can, and then we're talking to manufacturers to kind of say, well, how do we support with that? but we don't actually have that capability at the moment to be able to do it. But other areas, so our normal commercial fleets, like our transits or our customs or our couriers and stuff, we can transition now. And we kind of look at the low-hanging fruit to be able to kind of pick on that. But also, we wanted to be really ambitious to start with, and now we're kind of in a position where actually we just want to kind of, I think, run with the ZEV mandate and kind of be forced. And we're using that as our kind of our strategy leverage, I think, to kind of say, well, actually, as long as we hit that, we're kind of on target to kind of move forward with it, as opposed to trying to be trying to do something and fail. I think it's, I don't want us to kind of jump too far forward. We have made mistakes and we've kind of learned from them, but I don't want to keep making mistakes. I kind of want to kind of, I suppose, take a step back and kind of breathe for a bit.
Stabilise everything. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Is that quite difficult, though, for a fleet or any sort of business decision maker to say to their board, this is the strategy, it will change? Or is that acceptable?
I think that is acceptable. I would absolutely say our strategy has changed since we started. Right. And one thing I would say is don't be scared to change strategy. No point in ploughing a furrow if it's the wrong way you're going. So when we, a very quick story, but when we started putting cars out there, they're obviously the easier ones to do. We thought we could do the same thing with vans. And we came unstuck. And we have to go, no, wrong decision. Let's go back. Let's put something else in place to make sure we get that right. Because you can't, one size doesn't fit all. No. So all the things that work for a car driver don't work for a van driver.
Sure.
So you've got to change that strategy. You've got to be flexible. And you've also got to change that as you go through. And you have to do that on the fly sometimes. You know, you do have to do that. But there's no point in keep going. But absolutely, go to your board and say, got it wrong. This is what the outcome is. This is why I'm doing it. And I'm sure they will absolutely support you. So, absolutely. So.
And you won't be alone in that. That's industry-wide, isn't it, or sector-wide? Yeah. Matt, there's been a lot of talk of low-hanging fruit. How do you identify low-hanging fruit? What are they looking for?
Natasha touched on data earlier. Fleet data is absolutely key. And the low-hanging fruit expands as you put your first vehicles out there. So it's the vehicles, again, thinking operational fleet. It's the vehicles that can have a home charger fitted. It's the vehicles that don't go too far. It's the vehicles that aren't overloaded. It's the vehicles that aren't specifically converted into a tipper, as Matt says, or vehicles like that. So it's those simple ones which are really beneficial if the driver's excited about transitioning as well, because they can deliver a really good story for the other drivers in the fleet who may be reticent to it. Taking the data from telematics and fuel usage, you can see how your vehicles are really being utilized, removes the guesswork from it, and you can deliver or create your strategy on factual-based data rather than, yeah, that one does about 100 miles a day, that one does about 200 miles a day. So it's about getting that right. And just going back on the adjustment as you go, your learnings from your first vehicles will have the biggest impact on the adjustments as you make them, because you'll learn that vehicles do more than you thought they would, and they will operate differently to what you thought they would. So that piece around the changing strategy is really important to put out there at the start and say, this is where we're going from now. We're going to move as we go. Everybody's going to be flexible.
Fall off his chair.
Yeah, I'm just checking the mic works, yeah.
One of the things we found when we started our transition is you want some positive news stories to start with. So when you give your first ones out there, you want to give them to people that you look after, but also give you positive feedback, because workforces do speak to each other.
Yeah.
And if you end up with a detractor from it to start with, you're going to have that percolating through the rest of the workforce. So having those people that you trust and will give you a good story will then accelerate that kind of, oh, I want one of those because it all works for me, rather than I can't deal with that because I haven't got the range, or there's that problem or that problem. So those kind of picking those people to start with are really, really important.
I was going to say, there is a tricky group of people in organisations, and they are called drivers. So you're saying identify the ones that you think will sort of carry the torch.
Yeah, absolutely. When we started our car transition, we picked 10 trialists. So we did a trial. And we called them trialists because they've still got the cars now because they love them. But it was just kind of making sure we got 10 people that could give us positive feedback. That's preconceived. We didn't ask them to give positive feedback. They gave us positive feedback, but we knew that they would treat them and understand and work with us to get the right outcome, rather than somebody that's going to start off on the wrong foot. So, and that means that now, we are ordering pretty much 100% electric cars and all our new company car replacements, because that new story's gone and carried on. And the same with vans, you know, and I think that will be more challenging. We've certainly seen that with the van fleet conversion. That gets more challenging because those are the ones that really struggle to use those vehicles on a regular basis.
So. We demoed our vehicles, our commercial vehicles, for a year. So we, with one of the commercial vehicles, to kind of give that confidence back to the organisation, we put a ton of sand on the back of a Transit, and then one of our guys that kind of manages it internally for me, he literally drove it around in all weathers. So when people actually come to him to ask him, like, you know, how are you performing in winter weathers and all that sort of stuff, the vehicle never skipped a beat once. So he's never had any downtime on the vehicle to start with, as you would traditionally get with an electric vehicle, with a diesel vehicle. And the vehicle's been a lot more of a comfortable journey. He actually said his well-being was a lot better driving an EV as well. So as a commercial vehicle driver, with all the mod cons that it has on them, and you can preheat them and all the other little like fancy gadgets that you can kind of like sell into a driver, the actual whole experience of driving the EV compared to the diesel vehicle was a lot more of a positive one. So from a well-being perspective, it actually had a real positive impact on ours. And that's how we've kind of sold it back to our drivers, because they always want a benefit. So we've sold it back to them in that respect. And we've now got in a position only just recently where people are actually asking for them now. So we're asking for volunteers, and people are actually stepping forward now because they're wanting one, because they're either bored of sitting in garages because the diesel vehicles have broken down and stuff like that. But it's just been I don't think it's an easy thing to sell to a driver an EV, because as soon as they get in a vehicle, don't think they'll ever want to come out of it. Mm. It's just getting over that initial range anxiety.
Yeah.
And it's about understanding that actually there isn't a range anxiety. So Matt helped us do a lot of analysis around mileages. So we looked at dwell times and how what average mileage people did. And when people say to you they do 100 miles a day, when you actually look at their trackers, they probably do about 50 or 60. It's not, it's never normally the amount that they actually say. And then we say to people, do you know what, go and test it, see if you can do a full week in it and see if it's actually going to be sustainable. And it works. And we're kind of in a position now where we can actually do that. But we had to do a trial fully, like you mentioned, on a car fleet, which I think is a bit more emotive and it's a bit nicer thing. But I think operatives just don't want to, we call them operatives, drivers in our business, they just want to be able to get on with their work and do it without hassle. And we're kind of in the position now where we're saying, do you know what, if you take an EV, you won't have any of the issues you have with a diesel vehicle. So it's actually turning into a bit of a positive news story in our organisation, but it's literally taken me 2 years to get to that point.
Yeah, it's not an overnight thing. Natasha, range anxiety was mentioned, and I think range anxiety has been replaced by charging anxiety.
Yep.
People think, well, I know I can get, but where do I go? You know, and so what? You obviously have many conversations with fleets about that, I assume.
Yeah.
What? How do you educate them? What do you tell them?
I think, again, going back to Matt's point around data, there are so many clever pieces of kind of technology now that can help translate fleet management data, fleet optimization, and what we'll do is we can take that and then translate it into what actually works for you in a private environment, for example. So where you've got depots and bases, that information is crucial for a company like MER to then be able to help you understand what charging infrastructure you need. For us, it's fairly straightforward in terms of charging. You know, it's just trying to find the right chargers to go in the right environments. And understanding the logistics of an operation is fundamental, right? Because not one site will be the same. So you'll have so many different factors that we have to take into consideration. When it comes to on-route charging then, what that can identify is that a proportion of the fleet may rely on some on-route charging, which, you know, the public networks can help with. I think the biggest challenge, and we did touch on this, is those fleets that return to home. I think at the moment that's probably something in the industry that is a huge challenge, and I don't think that code has been cracked quite yet. So I'm sure that'll open up further conversation, but you know, we can only control those environments that have depots and back to bases and things like that, and we'll do all we can to get the right infrastructure in. But the key thing is the reliability of that. So once you map out the mileage the vehicles are doing and you can design your infrastructure to support that, that for us is the key bit. So
I think just touching base on what you're saying there as well. So like the home charging thing for us is our quick win or our low hanging fruit. We kind of use that as an example, which is how we've got our initial lot out, which is fine. But one of the things that we've discovered is that we work in a property environment, so we have like 50,000 homes that we can kind of attack lots of different infrastructure bases, but conscious that obviously everybody doesn't have that. So one of the things we've also found is actually we talk with like neighbouring companies or partners. That's how we kind of tackle in that that anxiety around, you know, we don't have that infrastructure base to be able to stick a piece of something in the ground, a piece of charging equipment in the ground. But however, you might find that somebody next door to you or an organisation or a neighbouring authority or something like that might have that infrastructure in place to do it. So we're having those conversations at the moment, and it's kind of, it's the only way I think that some companies will be able to do it. And it's, I think if everybody kind of doesn't work in silo, but actually works as more of a collective group, I think that's the only way we're actually going to be able to tackle this globally.
And that's where that collaboration piece comes in. Yeah. I mean, we work with some of the largest fleets in the country, and they still have those challenges. And, you know, we have a public side of our business, what we call a CPO. So you'll see some of our charging points on the motorway network, in big retail parks. The idea is now we'll merge the private business and the CPO business to try and find some really, we call them semi-private hubs. So we'll identify locations. As MER, we'll invest in the infrastructure to support those people that don't have the luxury of on-street parking. And, you know, we have to be accepting of the fact that, you know, that's somebody's private home. You know, do they want a workplace charger with a van on the drive? So it's just that collaboration piece is so important. And, you know, I'm not sat here saying that everyone's got all the answers today, but I think there's enough people that are trying to fight for the cause to try and make these things happen. Again, it goes back to data, because you need the systems and the management protocols behind it to be able to manage all of that. Because, of course, if you have a driver then leaving your depot that then goes to, say, I don't know, a Starbucks, where there's a bit more of a semi-private accessible charger for them, you have to be able to understand what they're using, how it's reimbursed, how they don't have to pay for it. Because, to be honest, the driver just wants an easy life, right? They come into work of a day, they don't really care. All they want to do is get in and know that the vehicle's going to get them from A to B. And if they're told to stop in this place, they probably need just a device that tells them, you need to please stop here, charge for half an hour, then move on, you can book a slot. So all of this stuff is out in the ether, but it's possible. It just takes the collaboration. And I think, you know, we're still not there, but I think we're moving in the right direction is the key thing.
Collaboration and planning, I think, isn't it? It's just plan your journey. It's
planning.
It's doable.
And I like Matt's point about the advocates, the drivers, because for me it's all about the knowledge piece. And I think if you can furnish them with the knowledge of how these things work, we do a lot of training with some of our customers where we go in with the manufacturer and just show them how to plug the vehicle in. Sounds crazy, and I do this day in, day out because I drive an electric car, but we have to understand that some of these drivers have never set foot in an electric vehicle before, have the anxiety about which side do I put the cable in, and is it the car or the van first, or is it the charger? And I think giving them that peace of mind that they've got just a couple of people on hand to show them how it's done. We create videos that can be shared on like intranets and things like that. And that for me, I think, goes a long way in just reducing some of that anxiety to help people on this journey.
Sure. I'd love this to be an interactive session, by the way. So if anybody does have any questions, please raise your hands. We have some roving mics, I think. Any questions now? I can move on.
No.
Oh. Joe, you mentioned vans. What are the pain points with vans?
Well, firstly, where you park them at night. So, you know, not only are we talking about changing our fleet to EVs and, you know, zero carbon in that respect, we're talking about reducing our carbon as a whole. So therefore, we stop vans return to base. So that return to base operation is finished now. So you can't plug them all in at night and charge them up so they're ready to go in the morning. So returning home with the workforce every night. Natasha's already mentioned about how we get you know, vans charged at night at home. So if you have got the luxury of a driveway you can park at home, most people are quite happy to have a company car there. It looks nice on the front driveway. Right, yeah. They don't want to park their pride and joy car on the road and then put their van on the driveway to charge at night. So you've got that challenge there in terms of that. I think the really interesting piece, as Matt's mentioned, is this collaborative charging in terms of using the charging network that is being built up out there. And it's not there yet, but it is being built up there in communities and being able to use those to charge vehicles. As a business operation, we have a real challenge with downtime in terms of unproductive time. So even if you need to charge a van quickly, 80%, you're going to take 45, 50 minutes, something like that, as a rule. That's a hell of a lot of costs that we've got to absorb to allow somebody to do that during the day, to do that part of the, during their day. So to have those facilities, those fast charging facilities, rather than ones that plug in at 7 kilowatts and take 12 hours to charge, you need to be doing that quickly during the day. And that infrastructure cost is massive. And that's the challenge, I think, for us going forward, is how we actually transition to the EV side, to van side EVs, to that kind of operation. Cars are very different. We don't see any real problems with those people. People have got used to charging those at home, setting off with a full charge, finding charge on the way back home to get them home. That's not a problem. It is the operational vans that will cause more problems for us as we go forward in terms of that transition. So.
And Matt Dale, you're obviously having conversations with people about exactly that.
Yeah, and it's a really tough one. Everybody's different. We used to be in a scenario where a van was a van was a van, and different companies ran different types. Now you've got, you can't cubbyhole everything. So from a housing association perspective, there is actually a really good opportunity for them to have infrastructure in their property portfolio and charge their vehicles at the other end of the scale. So they charge them while they're working rather than while they're at home. And you get multi-use out of the infrastructure. You can really maximise utilisation. And it's recognising that almost each driver's individual now. So if they can have a home charger, that's great. If they can't, what's the solution? You may have heard of CoCharger. They're just about to launch a commercial vehicle solution so that vans can charge on other people's drives. Downtime, as Joe's mentioned, is absolutely critical, especially if you're a fleet that is running engineers and things like that. It's not just the cost of the employee while he or she is charging, it's the cost that you would be billing. And I mean, when I was involved with the Mighty fleet, Mighty runs 7,500 vehicles, 3,500 vans, transitioned 1,500 of them up to the end of March this year. They actually put infrastructure where the vehicles dwell longest. So they would put infrastructure at the client's location if the driver couldn't have a home charger installed, because it was better to pay for infrastructure to go in and the charging than it was to have the downtime. And again, you maximise utilisation. And the other thing on infra, and I'm sure you'll agree with this, is think about it for the future, not just now. Think about who else is going to use it within your employee base. Whilst you might put it in for your company cars or company vans, if your employees park at your office, they are going to transition to electric. They will want to use that infrastructure in the future, and that is actually an opportunity to not necessarily create revenue from it, but they can help pay for the cost of the installation and the running of it. Mm. And then you can open it up in the evenings and allow other people to utilize it, as Tasha was saying about that collaborative approach. So yeah, vans are challenging, but you've got to start doing it.
I think on the collaboration piece, so like it's really important, I think, that we talk to each other. So like if, for example, like we've got 3,000 ugly sites, we call them, which are all basically abandoned garages. And we're in the process at the moment. We've got somebody physically going around surveying every single garage to see if we can turn them into a mini hub, so a mini EV hub. But we want to use them as an income generation stream then to be able to support our business. But also, we need other companies that aren't necessarily in the same industry as us, to come forward and say, do you know what? We would really kind of do with some charging in this particular area. We can then, that kind of support a business case internally for us to be able to put a small charging hub within that environment to be able to support that other operation. And we want to talk to like neighbouring local authorities and stuff like that and other councils to be able to support them that may not have the infrastructure to be able to do it themselves. We're lucky that we're a property company and we have lots of property and lots of land to be able to build on. But I think if people actually kind of collaborate a bit more and talk a bit more and say, well, actually, I've got this problem, you might find that the person you talk to might have a solution to say, well, actually, if we join together, we can put the infrastructure in for you, you can just pay for it, and obviously we can get an income off the back of it, and long term, it'll all kind of cancel itself out. But we've kind of resolved an issue just by having a bit of collaboration. And we're finding that the more and more conversations we're having, and it does mean, unfortunately, you will have lots of LinkedIn conversations with people, which I know can be frustrating sometimes, but you know, you can have some LinkedIn conversations with certain companies and talk to people like MER, or just individuals that are actually going through the experiences themselves at the moment, and you might find you've got the answers obviously staring at you directly in the face. We're just, at the moment, we just want to maximise, so EV aside, the infrastructure side of it is a big piece of what we're actually doing at the moment. We're focusing more on infrastructure now because we know it's going to support our EV evolution anyway. So we're kind of having a bit of a different stance at the moment. We're kind of going full, like Kung Po doing that, to kind of know that in the long term, next year, we're going to have to put more EVs on the road. So we're going to support with that element of it.
OK, can I just touch on one point as well? Sorry, that's really valid points. And the thing for me, connecting all of this around uptime is the infrastructure. The one thing you have to remember is that you need reliability, ultimately, because if you're relying as a fleet operator for your vehicles to turn up to certain charging points, then you have to have the confidence that these things are in good working order, that they're serviced and maintained correctly. And, you know, they're mechanical pieces of equipment. So for me, it's, you know, the design and how they're installed will mitigate a lot of the risk in terms of how they fail. But when it becomes a mechanical fault, a part might need replacing on that equipment. Just remember, you need to be working with organisations that can give you the confidence that they'll react quickly. There's a big stigma, I think, for infrastructure, especially in the public space, that, you know, these things don't bloody work, or that you pull up and it's just defunct, or the cables are missing. The fleet environment is totally different. The vehicles are business critical. So a lot of people focus on this front end piece around designing the right infrastructure, getting the right chargers in the ground. I said at the very beginning, it's a very overwhelming space to be. There's lots of charger manufacturers, lots of companies that can help you with this or claim to. For me, the piece of the puzzle then is the long-term longevity of that charging equipment. Does it do the job it needs you to do? And if these guys are relying on uptime as a key metric for their business, infrastructure could damage that massively if you don't get that right. So that, I just wanted to touch on that point.
That's fine. Okay, any questions? We've got 10 minutes left. No. You talked about SML.
Can I just we've already mentioned about the data piece. And if anyone's got telematics, you'll probably have an EV transition tool in that telematics system, which will show you the sweet spots of where your vehicles operate in terms of range, and also where they're based or where they're working to or coming back to on a regular basis. And that might be operational led, or it might be home-based led, but that gives you an idea of where you can invest in that infrastructure to keep that charging, because you can't put them everywhere. Yep. So you've got to pick those sweet spots, and therefore you've got to pick those yep. points there.
And if you have a telematics platform that doesn't have it in, we do. So I'm just going to put it out there. The fleet optimization is the beginning of the journey for us when we talk to our customers, because understanding what your vehicles do today is the key to understanding how they can then transition and which ones you can address first, because there will be a percentage that you can't do straight away, and it's identifying that. So little sales pitch there. Sorry.
That's what I'm here for.
There you go.
One of the, I think, fleet concerns is around SMR. You mentioned SMR earlier, and sort of running costs. How are you finding? But people will think it's much more expensive to repair an EV. Well, how's that been in practice for you?
So honestly, we haven't really seen much at the moment in regards to cost. I think that will come like further down the line. But at the moment, because we started our journey, like I said, 2 years ago, and it's took a long time to get the vehicles that we've got on the road. So the ones that we do like have on the road now, we haven't actually experienced any issues with them, apart from just a couple of recalls and a couple of like over air updates and things like that, which haven't really impacted us. So there hasn't been a massive cost for us. I'm not saying that's not going to come, because there obviously is a lot of anxiety around the cost of servicing and doing maintenance and repair on EVs. But we've personally not experienced it yet, but I think it's because we're too early in our thing. Sure. So we budget for it, and we kind of think it's coming, but like, it's either a touchwood moment or either we've got some really good vehicles, but we haven't experienced it yet.
Yeah. I think generally for us, reliability has been very good. I think where we have seen problems, you've got to plug it into a computer.
Yeah.
Rather than anything else, it doesn't take a mechanic these days. You've got to plug it into a computer for a software update or an ECU update or whatever the recall is. So it's a slightly different thought process. So we're not seeing those kind of mechanical breakdowns, but we are seeing this error warning message, and therefore it's got to go back in. And the only way they can fix it is by plugging it into a diagnostic, and then
which happens with an ICE vehicle as well.
It does, absolutely. But that's traditionally what the problems are with EVs that we've seen. So
I think with that as well, Joe, one of the things we've recently found is that people have been turning off the connectivity in the vehicle. So where you want over the air updates, which we had an over the air update recently, which actually increased the range, and I think it's by about 50 miles, just literally overnight. And the drivers actually come forward and said, I've suddenly got an extra 50 miles range. And when we tested it and we asked Ford about it, they had actually did an over-the-air update. So there is updates and stuff like that that have actually supported it with us. But we've had to go around and educate our operatives and drivers not to turn off the connectivity inside the vehicle.
Yeah, and that was part of our strategy in terms of how we help people drive these vehicles. because they're not the same as driving a nice vehicle. They are, you know, you've got to put some stuff in there, you've got to set the right settings, and everyone has got a happy mode, and it's also got a slow mode, and you know, whichever one you pick, you know, is going to change what you do in the range and how you drive the vehicle. So drivers need advice on how to use these and such like, so you've got to give that right information out from the start.
Okay, Matt, SMR, any comments?
Yeah, I mean, it's a really interesting space again. From a Mighty perspective, as well as 1,500 electric vans, we had over 3,000 cars. We saw, just to quell a couple of myths, no increase in tyre wear, no increase in tyre spend. A 3.5-ton van, whether it's electric or internal combustion engine, is still 3.5-ton gross vehicle weight. So, yeah, you'll get a bit more wear on acceleration, potentially. Our downtime decreased, both in accident and maintenance, and that was across a broad spectrum of vehicles, mixture of a lot of Stellantis on the van side, a lot of ID Buzz on the van side, but also on the car side, you've got Tesla, you've got Kia, you've got MG, and we saw everything coming down to the extent that we actually cancelled our maintenance contract with our lease provider and went self-maintained because it was better for us, because we were paying for a potential risk that potentially was never going to come. So I think there's been a lot of negative media about the maintenance and the downtime that you get with electric vehicles, that in reality, our experience was on a large fleet, it didn't exist.
I think that's because it's just an unknown, isn't it, really? Whereas actually the people that are actually experiencing it will actually see, we're not seeing those issues. I'm not saying there isn't, some people do, but I think...
Well, sorry, Matt, we heard in the last session, be careful what you read in the press, because you will hear stories that actually, apart from Fleet News, of course, you will hear stories that will make you form judgments, and very often those judgments are incorrect. So tyre wear is the classic one, isn't it?
Yeah.
And we've spoken to Bridgestone about that, we've spoken to our tyre providers about that, that they are seeing no increase in tyre wear on EVs.
Yeah, so, there's definitely an anti-EV.
There is, yeah,
agenda.
And you need to be careful. We look at data, we look at the right information. People that run these things, and large numbers of them, like Matt is at Mighty, you know, these are the people that should be trusted in terms of that information, because they're seeing real world examples. So.
Sure.
We didn't have any fires either.
Nope.
Oh, okay. Now we've got about 2 minutes. I've got two questions. Okay. There is a mic coming. So. Oh.
Yeah, very quick one. What about battery life? Is that something you have to build into sort of total cost of ownership calculations and also refreshing of the fleet? Do you have to do that sooner, or does it have any impact at all in terms of battery life?
We saw nothing on battery degradation that was outside of the normal. We expected to see up to 3% per annum, but it hasn't been coming true. Now, one of the reasons we expect that is happening in a general industry view is that when the manufacturers build the vehicles, they leave some extra capacity in there. And as the cells start to deteriorate, they're releasing other cells. You know, these vehicles are connected. They're extremely intelligent. They're extremely clever in what they do. So, yeah, degradation. Haven't seen anything that's impacted anything for a client. I did some work with a supermarket. We did some trials with them, and even doing charging twice a day on rapid chargers over a 12-month period. Very, very minimal.
Okay, and then just one more question there, please. Thanks.
Thank you. Just a query on, say, red herrings in the press. Have any of the panel noticed any insurance premium hikes as you've moved to fiendishly expensive, complicated death traps, if you believe the press, some of the press?
Well, when I talk to my insurer about it, they've not... All they're interested in is around the total value of the vehicle. They've not really been that interested in the EVs. So I've said to them, like, you know, we've got 40 EVs. I made sure we really, like, clearly state that we've got 40 EVs, what they actually are, so they can quote effectively. But they're just like, we only want to know the value. So if you've got anything over our insurers at the moment, say, if you've got anything over 50 grand, we want to know about it. Well, they're not. So we tell them we've got them. They have a fleet list, but they're not really that interested. I think they do put a contingency in place when I've asked them about it. What are you doing? They have said they are having a contingency in place because of the battery and because of how expensive it is, but they've not really said you'll see a vast increase. And our fleet hasn't got a mass amount of EVs on it at the moment, so I guess it isn't so much of a risk. So I don't know how many have you got, John?
Yeah, well, probably about 80 or so in total. I think the challenge the insurance industry's got is in terms of how it deals with fleet policies. Like ours, we just buy a single policy for a year, so it's a single premium. And you can not hide, but those EVs get swallowed up into a much bigger pot. If you're individually insuring EVs, I know that insurers have got concerns around them. The main concern, and Matt's probably heard this as well, the main concern is around how you repair batteries if batteries get damaged. The actual metal, it's not that difficult. It's the same as ordinary metal on an ICE vehicle, but if that battery gets damaged, that's the really costly bit. And I think they just don't know enough yet. They haven't seen enough of them. They have that kind of market to repair batteries after accidents is not there yet. So those kind of specialist repairers, certain manufacturers don't even allow you to repair batteries. So you've got these kind of issues, and it's actually just an education piece for insurers to understand that. So just be careful of those individual insurance costs, because I think, insurers may well, if you're insuring one or two vehicles individually, may well put a cost increase on that because of that. But if it's a fleet policy, we haven't seen any increase in cost, no.
And on that positive note, thank you very much to the panel, Matt, Joe, Matt and Natasha, and thanks for your questions, and thanks for coming. Thank you very much. Cheers.